I've done a lot of it myself, but then I realized that 90% of our babies are term, and there is a lot of morbidity, which I'm going to talk about, which goes unnoticed in the newborn period. And the reason, we will explore the reasons together, because it's the responsibility of all of us pediatricians to look after these term babies. So I bring greetings from PIMS, and if you can all hear me, I will. Okay, and now. Okay. So I wanted to first discuss that our doctor's bag, the pediatrician's bag, should now change a little bit. And when we join an institution or we are consultant in a nursing home where babies are being delivered, I think a whole new set of equipment we must insist upon, which is now available and affordable. And this will help us in giving good care to babies. For example, we must insist on an electronic weighing machine, the spring balances, and the other one in which we used to all weigh placenta. All that must go. We must get ourselves a good ophthalmoscope, if possible, a transcutaneous bilirubinometer. I can let you into a secret. If you buy some ventilators, the bilirubinometer will come free. Then a pulse oximeter, at least a finger one. NIBP with neonatal cuffs, glucometer and accessories. Now, every institution that cares for babies, whether they have an NICU or not, I think the pediatrician attending to babies in that hospital must make sure that these equipments are available. Now, personally, I think we should carry a non-stretchable tape. We say this in the postgraduate course. We say this to MBBS students. When we become consultants, we don't carry a tape. And I think personally, we should clean the tape after each or get the disposable paper tips. Pen torch with no central shadow. Now you must choose this torch where you can directly put light on the pupils of the baby and see the reaction, look for cataract, whatever. A neonatal stethoscope. I think gone are the days when we sort of should borrow a stethoscope from the labor room and quickly try to auscultate a baby. I think neonatal steths are cheap and available everywhere with a small diaphragm. We should carry some growth charts in our office bag. You can put these charts inside plastic pouches and keep it for reference when you see a baby. A finger pulse oximeter is a must, if possible, and if we learn how to use a glucometer. We must carry one with lancet and strips, and of course, a hand sanitizer. So having said that, Okay. Now, what are the objectives of postnatal care? The first is evaluation for need of resuscitation. That we all know, and all of us are doing this. And today, I'm not going to touch upon resuscitation. Complete physical examination of the baby, administration of medications, administration of vaccines, checking adequacy of feeding, most often it's breastfeeding, safe sleeping habits of the baby, hygiene of baby, which translates to cleanliness, prevention of sepsis, etc., and screening for disease conditions. Now, I have prepared this table, which will give you an overall view of what I feel are the number of things that one should do for a newborn, a postnatal normal term newborn. So when we, let's go one by one into this and see what are all the things. So anything which is obvious like breastfeeding, latching, you know, I'm not going to talk about those things. I'm just going to talk about the extra things that we all seem to have forgotten that we should do for term newborns. So on the resuscitation table, a quick examination to check for cleft palate, and the previous speaker mentioned posterior one-third of the palate. Very, very important, because if the neonatologist or the pediatrician at birth does not do this examination, you will then be caught out when the baby regurgitates milk or his speech is inaccurate or delayed later on in life. And believe me, that can be very embarrassing. Check for the apex beat position with our fingers, we must locate the apex pit. Because in case the diaphragmatic hernia or a pneumothorax is missed, that is the time to pick it up, or we pick up a dextrocardia with its attendant other syndromes. Look for two arteries and one vein, because once the umbilical cord is cut off, we are never going to find that. Though in these days with antenatal ultrasound, it probably is less important. Genitalia, a very big social emergency. We had a set of parents whose mother, who the wife, the lady had delivered a second baby. It was a male. Family had celebrations. Mother had tubectomy. And then baby was referred to us for severe vomiting, and we found that it was masculinization. And we just, it was born outside, referred to us. We did not know how to explain to the parents that it was a female child. So these kind of situations can be avoided. A very detailed examination to establish the sex of the baby is important. Anus patency, back and spine. And then the baby should be quickly handed over the mother. This is obviously after establishing resuscitation and vital signs. The second thing, the next thing is day one examination. In day one examination, most often we do not repeat what was done at the resus table. And the most important thing to check here is clinical ictus, because jaundice missed in the first 24 hours can have very complicated, many complications. So clinical ictus is to be checked at least twice in the first 24 hours. This can be done by us or a trained nurse, or of course, postgraduates who have to document that they have looked at the baby, checked for jaundice, and what is the level of clinical ictus. This is the only way to pick up day one hemolytic jaundice. If we don't look for it, we will not pick it up. Now, this is the time also on day one that a detailed examination of the baby is done from head to foot, preferably in the presence of both parents. This gives them, we have all read in the books, that this gives them an opportunity to ask us questions, clear their doubts, and we can start talking about breastfeeding at this point. The four items I find in the physical examination quite often missed at this point is developmental dysplasia of hip, peripheral pulses, eyes for cataract, and neonatal reflexes. So do remember to include this so that you can follow up and see, in case it's not conclusive on day one, you have still have time to repeat it on daily routine examination. Head circumference is something that I would always request physicians to do it themselves, because we depend upon head circumference to assess development and growth in the first 6 months, and I think it is should be measured accurately and documented. And of course, by this time, if there are any neonatal stigma, the baby, the parents can be reassured. The next set of examination is daily routine examination, because once the baby has had his day one examination, at which point you may include assessment of gestational age. But this skill is fast disappearing, because the obstetricians and sonologists give us very accurate expected date of delivery. But if it has to be done, day one is probably the best time to do it. So in the daily routine examination, this can, a nurse can be trained to do this. Most of the time, the what I call the professors of the postnatal ward, which is the first year postgraduate and the student nurse. This is the team nowadays that we leave in the postnatal ward. And you will find that they have to be taught what they should see in the baby every day. So the first thing is activity, suck and cry. Temperature goes without saying, any hypothermia they should report. Calculation of weight loss, we'll talk about that a little more later. Presence and severity of ictus, appearance of scaphal hematoma. What is the umbilicus doing? Is there a discharge? Is it separating? Is there foul smell? Change in the stool color. Very, very important that the meconium changes and becomes light green and then yellow. If this change in meconium color doesn't happen, one has to think of inadequate breastfeeding. So it is just a cue, and it is nice to watch out for a change in the meconium color. Urine frequency, we all know, at least 6 thoroughly wet diapers. Small bits of urine on the diaper is not enough. 6 soaking wet diapers, at least in 24 hours. At this point, again, any concerns from the parents should be addressed. The next is discharge. Yes. Discharge planning. Now, discharge planning should be done a day before the child is planned to be discharged. This, of course, makes the billing section and the administrators very happy because they are prepared with the discharge summary, prepared with everything. But parents have to be informed so that in most places where they have to pay up or they have to complete formalities, so it's always better to plan for discharge the day before. If there is a delay in the treatment of the baby, suppose you need phototherapy for a few more days, I think it is nice to be in communication with the obstetrician, inform them about the delay in discharge of the baby so that they can make arrangements for the mother. At this point, the maternal history should be reviewed again. I personally have got caught out once where I have asked the mother, how many children do you have? She said, 2. So I said, okay, how old is the other child? She said, 3 years old. This is the second child. What she did not tell me was she had 2 other neonatal deaths, which she thought if they had died, she doesn't have to tell us. Of course, now we are all wiser. We do our go by G1, G2, G3, G4, G5. So we go through every gravida status in the mother and we ask for history. But in case something has been missed out, it is a nice time to review maternal history. Reviewing of the antenatal ultrasound reports. I think our fetal medicine and sonologist friends do an excellent job in the fetal clinic. I think things like antenatal hydronephrosis or just a mild thickening of the bladder or something else, I think all these issues can be resolved and followed up if we care to look at, because sometimes if you're called for delivery and there is no time to review all this, you may miss it. So at the time of discharge, one needs to go back to the mother and look up her antenatal ultrasound report. Now, all the investigation that have been done for the baby during his stay, which we will talk about, needs review. We need to explain to the parents the results that have come and some of the results which are pending and give them a suitable follow-up date. Of course, at this point, we should definitely observe breastfeed, make sure the latching is good. If there is a trained lactation nurse, she can certify perhaps that the mother has been taught how to latch and how to feed the baby. Now, at the time of discharge, along with weight and head circumference, a detailed examination of the cardiovascular system must be done at this point. The jaundice must be risk categorized and it has to be, one has to decide, are we going to follow up this jaundice or not follow up the jaundice? Has it been resolved? And then red reflex and pulse oximetry. Now, these things are being done in individual units, perhaps a few centers in India, but this is cost effective and it must be done in every private nursing home, everywhere. That is why I feel for 800 or 2,500 rupees, a finger pulse oximeter must be a part of a pediatrician's kit when you go visiting to different nursing homes. Of course, in a teaching hospital, you can have a Masimo pulse oximeter or any other pulse oximeter which picks up signals in babies, and we can. And we all know that nowadays pulse oximetry is becoming a part of neonatal resuscitation. So the same thing can be used to check babies in the postnatal ward. Now, one more examination. We were traditionally teaching these 4 examinations to all medical students, interns, postgraduates. Now, with passage of time, I feel this particular examination also becomes very, very important, because insisting on exclusive demand breastfeeding is all very well, as long as at the time of discharge, the baby has learned to latch and the mother has learned to feed. And by day 14, you convince yourself that the birth weight has been regained. Now, many a baby has suffered hypernatremic dehydration in a series in our own hospital. More than 9% of babies suffered more than 12% weight loss, with serum sodium ranging from 148 to 160. And with time, this came down, because the minute our weight loss touched 10%, our postgraduates to jump in and send electrolytes and then plan on hydrating the baby or counseling on breastfeeding. So we are seeing a decrease in our numbers, but many a baby have been referred to us with inconsolable cry, with a decreased urine output, and then we find sodiums are ranging from above 150 in many cases. So it's very, very important, and responsibility is on us when we discharge a baby to get them back and make sure that birth weight has been regained. Now, CVS, this is the time when left to right shunts start manifesting. You may start hearing murmurs at this point. A neonatal step is important. One needs to look for peripheral pulses and left to right shunt or a murmur at this point. We all know that cyanotic heart disease do not give too many murmurs, but at least we can pick up early signs of a cyanotic heart disease left to right shunt. Development dysplasia of hip is something we need to keep checking in all these visits, especially 6 weeks, 10 weeks, and 14 weeks. But at 14 weeks, again, we have to check after discharge. Now, if having completed this set of examination, which we are obliged to do for all term babies in the postnatal period, let's look at anthropometry. Now, we all know at birth, we get done. Like I said, it would be preferable if physicians themselves do the head circumference, but you know nurses take weight, length, and chest circumference and document it in the chart. So we have this information available with us. Now, I know a Fenton chart is used for preterms, but we have searched and searched and searched something similar to Fenton chart in a term baby. And we actually wrote an email to the Canadian group that made this chart and said, why don't you make one for term babies? Because it is so useful in identifying many of these conditions. So the information on weight, head circumference and length is available for every single baby in this country virtually. But how do we make use of this kind of information? So just a simple, to give you an example. Now, you know that Fenton chart has a separate girls and a boys chart for the last 3-4 years. Now, if you look at this set of numbers, you can see that the birth weight is below the third percentile and the head circumference also below the second, almost near the third percentile. So it gives you a clue. Are we dealing with fetal growth restriction or some kind of symmetric IUGR? It gives an early indication. If you plot this on the baby, there is something happening here. Now, similarly, asymmetric IUGR may look like this. So we encourage our juniors to plot as soon as a baby is born, which gives us an idea what may be happening. Now, this could be an infant of diabetic mother where there is macrosomia or a large for gestational age baby with a normal head circumference. Now, if you had a large for gestational age baby with a length which is in the higher percentile and head circumference also in the higher percentile, that would be a large baby. So this could be a simple technique. Now, this one shows a short length macrocephaly or at least a large head circumference and a normal weight. Actually, when we got this kind of chart, we then later diagnosed a baby who developed achondroplasia. Now, if there is just short stature, head and chest head circumference and weight is in the correct percentile, and you find short stature, should the child develop hypoglycemia? One could think of pituitary. So it is not a final diagnosis, but having the information, if you make use of it. So that is the reason why I said few growth charts. It could be this, it could be the intergrowth chart, it could be a WHO chart, but this is spread out. So it allows you to see what's happening. You can correlate the length, head circumference and weight and get some idea of the baby. Obviously, if everything is on the 50th percentile, the baby probably is normal anthropometry wise. Now, daily weight loss, we talked about it. Sorry. One second. Yeah, thank you. So now, birth weight is defined as weight taken within 1 hour of birth. Now, a lot of my visits to villages or smaller places or other hospitals during my tenure in Manipal when I was doing a lot of community work, birth weights are rarely taken before 1 hour of birth. So it becomes imperative that wherever we are attending and wherever we are teaching, we must insist on birth weight being taken within 1 hour with an electronic weighing machine. The baby should preferably be weighed at the same time every day with just a nappy. And if the weight exceeds 10%, one should think of doing further, definitely not discharge the baby till you can see no weight loss or weight gain. So it is important to calculate percentage weight loss. And there are reports where people have called this a silent epidemic in breastfed babies, hypernatremic dehydration. So one has to guard against this and be a little maniac in calculating weight loss in babies. Red reflex. This is again a procedure which is often advocated by ophthalmologists. And it is something that should become a routine practice amongst all of us pediatricians. There are reports from this paper, particular papers from Pakistan, but there are reports from India also where in maternity units, assessment of red reflex is very patchy. And if you don't diagnose blindness by 3 months, it can be very, very difficult afterwards. So the procedure is to use an ophthalmoscope, set the number at zero, keep the aperture fully open. Light should cover the baby's face like this. And we should stand far away. The ophthalmoscope should be near our eyes and the light should shine on the baby's face like this. And wait for the red reflex from both eyes. So here you can see one eye has red reflex and the other is doubtful. Congenital cataracts, 60%. Retinoblastoma, retinal detachment. Of course, I'm not including ROP here because this is all about term babies. Very important to include red reflex in our itinerary for postnatal babies. Pulse oximetry. That brings me to this important topic. 8 out of 1,000 newborns have congenital heart disease, probably more in India. We really don't know the incidence. It's only babies who come to our attention that we are treating. And 2 in 1,000 is serious. It's very difficult to pick up congenital heart disease in utero. You need expertise, you need time to look for the four-chambered heart, look for the large vessel, though today the fetal medicine is doing a good job. But how many people have actually access to these expert fetal medicine people? Now, fetal echo again is even more rare, difficult to do, usually done in families where a previous child has died of congenital heart disease. So when we combine pulse oximetry with a good clinical examination, and when I say good clinical examination, it means at discharge, one is looking for all peripheral pulses, looking for a levocardia, murmur. And once we have ruled out all this, and then we add pulse oximetry to this set of physical examination, the yield is very good, and it will certainly help us to pick up critical cyanotic or congenital cyanotic heart disease. The ideal time is around 24 hours of age. It could be at discharge, it could be on day 2 or day 3, but some cases may be missed, not done at 24 hours. Now, basically, the right hand, which is preductal, one probe should be put here. You could have 2 finger probes, and it should be done simultaneously. You put another one on the foot, and then look at the reading and then decide. So what we do in our hospital is put the finger probe, the adult one on the foot, and then we put one like this on the hand because that is attached to a machine, and then we read. And if there is, both are more than 95%, nothing needs to be done. And it should be 95% or above, at least 30 seconds to 1 minute, then the baby can pass this test along with a normal cardiovascular examination. Then nothing needs to be done. And if the upper limb and lower limb show only between 91 and 94, it needs to be repeated after 1 hour and then again after another 1 hour. If it remains low in all 3 readings, the baby should be shifted to NICU for further evaluation, which includes sepsis. saturation below 90% in the right upper limb or lower limb at the first instance, shift to NICU. So it's a very simple technique, and you know, most of the babies will show good saturations. It's cost effective. It just needs, it's not, it's person expensive. For example, in a Western country, they would compute the cost of a nurse who does all this. But in India, this is something simple that we can do. And today, many, many places have pediatric cardiologists who will do echocardiography, confirm the finding, and we can still refer to a nearby cardiac surgical unit. So, but making the attempt to do this pulse oximetry is what the maternity units and pediatricians have to start doing. Hearing screen, I know Dr. Abraham Paul has already spoken about it. All that we want to say here is screen before 1 month, diagnose before 3 months, start intervention before 6 months. So 180 days is the cutoff before which a diagnosis should have been made. And the previous speaker also spoke about universal newborn hearing screen. So there is really no need for me to further delve into that, but it's an important part of postnatal care. Now, investigations. Cord TSH. The incidence of congenital hypothyroidism in India is much, much higher than what is reported from the West for various reasons. But the data is from isolated hospitals and units. Some of the hospitals, especially a PhD thesis from CMC Velo, have looked at 2 lakh or 1.75 lakh TSH, cord TSH, and correlated with development of congenital hypothyroidism. So there are other such hospitals. Our own hospital does congenital hypothyroidism. So the reason why it is important to do it at birth is because the prognosis is best when treatment is commenced before 2 weeks. Now, it takes time to get the results and then confirm the result, and the patient may be lost to follow up. So basically, no newborn delivered in a health facility should go home without a TSH assessment. I think this should be remembered, and we all should make an attempt to see that discharge summary should have a mention, TSH in the cord, or because there's no point doing it on third or fourth day. By then, the mother is discharged. So cord TSH is normal. So a cutoff value of more than 20 milli international units per liter will warrant further investigation, and above 25, the CMC study shows less recall, but in our own institution, we use 20 and above as a cutoff. So cord TSH, again, should be an important, and most hospitals where deliveries are done have access, because nowadays, obstetrician tests for maternal hypothyroidism almost in every single mother. So one should be able to be near a lab, which should give us a cord TSH within 24 hours of delivery. The next is serum bilirubin. We all know Dr. Bhutani's chart. I'm sure we use it. Now, many people confuse this with commencement of phototherapy. But with time and with more and more postgraduates being taught how to use this chart and nomogram, this confusion has cleared, I hope. This is only a risk assessment chart where I will show you in the subsequent slide what you do with this information that you get here. Now, for this, 2 ways of determining serum bilirubin are there. One is clinical, not very accurate. Second is a transcutaneous bilirubinometer if it's available. But to assign risk to the baby, one does need to confirm with a serum total bilirubin. The third is, of course, doing serum total bilirubin at some fixed point in the early neonatal period. In our institution, we do this at 48 hours. We also do 2 checks on a newborn on day one. So we don't miss clinical jaundice on day one. The second day, we would do a transcutaneous bilirubinometer. And the third day, at 48 hours, we would prick the child and do a total serum bilirubin. Now, what has happened with this approach is we have almost eliminated any of our babies from returning with severe jaundice for phototherapy. In fact, one of the aims of Dr. Bhutani's study was to see that babies who get discharged early do not come back with jaundice levels which are near Kernicterus. So, and we have also done our own bilirubin values and a nomogram which closely matches that which has been described by Dr. Bhutani. So it looks like it has a universal appeal and it can be used, though there are other papers which dispute this. But for us, we found the correlation between our results and what he has found are extremely close. Now, once the bilirubin has been determined at 48 hours, we would plot, we'll try to see whether it falls in the high risk, intermediate or low risk. Also, whether the baby has any risk factors. You could use this or you could use this useful app or calculator. It's called www.billytool.org. Please look up this in your phone. Use it for every baby that you see in the nursing home before discharge, every baby that is seen in the postnatal ward. You can even use this if you're using just a transcutaneous bilirubin meter. You can also use this if you're clinically assessing jaundice. It doesn't matter. But of course, the gold standard is a total serum bilirubin. So once this is put, and I have empirically put a value of 16 at about 30 or 36 hours of life. And when I press submit, I find that the baby is at high risk. Then I would check whether the baby has any other risk factors, which is given here. Jaundice in the first 24 hours, ABO incompatibility. You can see that whether the gestational age is a late preterm, whether previous sibling had phototherapy. So all these risk factors are given here based on the risk factor, whether it's a lower risk or higher risk or medium risk. You can then decide to start. You can evaluate for phototherapy. And to evaluate for phototherapy, you could click on these R-specific nomogram, which is the AAP nomogram. And you could institute phototherapy. Now, once babies are screened like this and high-risk babies, the parents are counseled that you must stay back. We must repeat the bilirubin after 12 hours. You can go after that if the rate of rise. The parents do understand because it's much better than rushing in the middle of the night with a very, very yellow baby or a baby with bilirubin-induced damage. So this is about what we do with bilirubin nowadays. I think we have to go a little beyond taking out the clothes, looking at the baby. You come back after 2 weeks. No, we have to take a more proactive stance and see that we risk categorize and then we decide what we are going to do with the baby. The other thing that maybe we should keep in mind is a complete blood count. Now, why do I say this? Very often, we do a septic workup. Very often, complete blood counts are available in the baby's chart. But we do not look at it from a different point of view. We just look at the neutrophilia or toxic granules or a total count. And then we say, okay, sepsis irukku illa. Why don't we look a little beyond that? Now, if the baby's anemic, suppose the baby's hemoglobin is 10. Could be a fetometallic hemorrhage. It could be some bone marrow disorder. I understand that these are rare. But if there is a value available, or secondly, when you're doing a 48-hour bilirubin, if your institution or you have decided, you could always send a CBC along with it. Have a look at it. See if you can pick up something. What we do, have been doing for the last 1 year in our institution, is calculating the absolute lymphocyte count in all babies at discharge, just to see. What is it happening in our country? Even though our sample may be small, but we still wanted to know what was happening. And we picked up one SCID. But I'm not saying SCID is common. I'm not saying lymphocytes have to be done in everybody. But if you do have a value, make it a habit to calculate the absolute lymphocyte count. If it's above 4,000, no issues. Everything is good. If it's below 2,500, it may warrant a repeat lymphocyte count at the age of 1 month. So it's just looking at things differently with the data that we have already for every baby in most hospitals. Now, red cell indices. again, with a Coulter counter, you find that these indices are being given to us. But a lot of us are not familiar. We don't look at it. But one thing, a high mean corpuscular hemoglobin concentration above 36 could explain why the baby has jaundice. It could be a congenital serocytosis, which is not so rare, in our country. And you may find that the jaundice is unexplained. The mother and baby has same blood group, DCT negative, but still the baby has enough bilirubin that you have to give phototherapy. So maybe these things can give a little clue, and a peripheral smear is invaluable. The problem with peripheral smear depends on the interpreter. Not very many people may be experienced, but if you do happen to work in a setup, especially mission hospitals, large teaching hospitals, medical college hospitals, you may have a pathologist who will give you red cell morphology, or they may pick up microspherocytes. DCT may be negative. You may pick up microspherocytes in a baby who's B group and mother is O group. It could be an OB incompatibility instead of wondering, why is this baby jaundiced? So we have picked up a case of congenital malaria in my previous hospital. The baby came with hepatosplenomegaly with fever and just picked up a malaria. So looking at the peripheral smear can also yield very good results. So in the postnatal period, especially early postnatal period, when many investigations, when something is being done to a baby, we must pay attention to see what other information we can squeeze out of the results that we have available with us. Newborn screening and tandem mass spectroscopy. Now, this is a new thing. In the last 5 years, it has become the buzzword. Now, there is no particular policy, but this article by Thomas Mukul, he is involved with a lab, but I found the article extremely informative about the state of newborn screening. It has been published only this year, June 2020 or something, and gives a lot of information about the state of screening for metabolic disorders and hemoglobinopathies in our country, because data from India are so lacking. There is no particular policy. In a review that he did, less than 3% of all babies born, which is 27 million, had something. Some tests done on them. And most of them were sick babies. They were not the well babies. Now, private hospitals have started screening for various reasons, because it's something that the patient opts for because they're willing to pay. And there are that kind of patients who come to private hospitals who are aware of this from abroad. They come requesting for a screening. So patchy screening is being done, but data is not collated. The government of India doesn't know what's happening with all this screening results that we are storing, including our own institution. We are doing for the last 4 years, but we are submitting to nobody because nobody is asking us. So only 3 states have a government program, Chandigarh, Goa, and Kerala. They all started, I think at least Goa started big with TMS and the newborn, you know, all the other screening. But most have given up. But Kerala seems to be going in the right direction. I think people from Kerala should be able to tell us more about it. They are going in the direction of doing the screening in a big way along with TMS. Maybe we will get some results from Kerala in a year or two. Now, if a birth hospital can do nothing else, at least do a cord TSH. So this, and I would not include TSH in any other newborn screening panel, because every baby delivered deserves a cord TSH. It is cost effective, treatment is cheap, it's available, and it's a preventable cause of mental retardation, as you all know. So we have to make a commitment to do cord TSH. Now, there are 2 types of panels. So one panel is 6 common disorders, congenital adrenal hyperplasia, G6PD deficiency, galactosemia, biotinidase deficiency, cystic fibrosis. Now, out of all this, I would think G6PD deficiency and congenital hypothyroidism would be top priority. If only 2 tests can be done, congenital hypothyroidism, G6PD deficiency. If something more can be done, CAH definitely helps male babies, because you will not have ambiguous genitalia in male babies. And ICMR has found CAH is the next common inherited disorder in our country. The others, of course, take go very low. They are rare. But if you do diagnose, treatment is available of some kind, at least for galactosemia and biotinidase. So this is called the newborn screening, as people call it. It has come into common language and we all call this newborn screening. We offer this to some parents who do not want the full panel, which is the tandem mass spectroscopy. Now,
this, another 5 to 7 minutes, madam. Another five to seven minutes.
Yeah.
Thank you, madam.
So, tandem mass spectroscopy is available in a couple of big labs. It has a downtime of about 3 to 5 days. It is being offered in by many hospitals. It can be expensive. But if it is done universally by the Indian government, if a time arrives, maybe in another 10 or 20 years, you may find that the whole scenario has changed and we really get to know what is ailing our babies in terms of inherited metabolic disorders. So at PIMS, we do cord TSH 100% for everybody. Newborn panel is offered to some parents. TMS 62, which also includes hemoglobinopathies, and as you all know, is offered to parents who can pay for it. But we have found with good counseling, 90% of parents accept tandem mass spectroscopy. If we send tandem mass, we don't have to do the newborn screening because it is included in that. Now, treatment, we all know vitamin K. This is the only thing for which I found proper guidelines. There's no ambiguity. Every child in the country, whether it be born in government hospital, private, anywhere, if it is in a hospital facility, vitamin K must be given, and we all are aware of this. So I will not dwell too long on this. Eye drops, again, there are various, depending on the hospital, there's silver nitrate. Some people have erythromycin ointments. In our hospital, we are not using anything. We closely follow the babies and see. It could be because our deliveries may be much less than some bigger hospitals. Now, vaccines. Just two words here. Hepatitis B vaccine. Now, CDC recommend be given within 12 hours. We ourselves were giving at discharge or on a certain vaccination day when the sister comes giving the BCG vaccine. So we have made a small shift in our strategy. We give interns an opportunity to give an intramuscular injection under the supervision of our consultant. And we recommend that it be given on the other thigh along with vitamin K. Vitamin K on one side and Hep B, so that it finishes. And what we also realize is it's the babies coming into NICU who get delayed hepatitis B vaccine. So again, we have informed the NICU sisters that they must give hepatitis B vaccine to all babies soon after admission. So this has improved our uptake of hepatitis B vaccine. Another category of mothers who we often leave out are those who come with unknown status because they do not wait for their hepatitis B results and they are discharged. So I think this group of mothers, which are becoming fewer and fewer now, but still this needs to be followed up, or these babies should be treated as hep positive when they are having unknown status. Now, one word about lymphopenia. So there is a question. If you go chasing for a shadow, you'll get into trouble. Because if you find lymphopenia, do you administer live vaccines or not? So this question was raised by one of our very junior postgraduates. We looked up literature and found in India, priority is to give the vaccine lymphopenia or not. So basically, even if we find lymphopenia, we do give the vaccine, live vaccines, which we may call them back after a month. So that's just in case somebody had a clarification. This brings us to the last part. And the reason why I have put this in capital letters, most important, the parents and the counseling. So let us now look for what do we ask when we want to discharge a mother? Is she ready for discharge? Is her home ready to receive the baby? Is everybody prepared? Have they bought dresses? Has all that been done? Is the baby feeding well? Does he sleep after the feed? Signs of adequate breastfeeding. How is the stool, urine frequency, latching and sucking? And what is her plan for breastfeeding? She may be a working mother. She may have other plans. We don't know. We have to have a free and fair discussion with the mother. Give her an opportunity to raise her doubts. So that counseling has to be given at least for 10 or 15 minutes or before the mother goes home. We must check whether, again, mother's history, any previous child deaths or problems, review antenatal scans, whether baby has lost more than 10% birth weight, metabolic screening, if it has been done, have we got the results? Who will get the results? Will parents get a courier? How will we know what has happened to the results? What is the cord TSH? If it's more than 20, mother should not be discharged. A repeat free T4 and thyroid stimulating hormone should be done on day 4. Pulse oximetry, has it been done and passed? Any ictus, is there a need for further review? Or is the chapter on ictus closed for this baby? Have all vaccines been given? Has vitamin D prescribed? Again, two question marks. A paper by Dr. Balasubramaniam Child Trust says, we need to give vitamin D. Then he said every institution should decide. So, you know, but so we have finally, with COVID and everything, decided we will give vitamin D. Whether it's right or wrong, I leave it to the panel and audience to decide. Inform the parents about follow-up. Inform about various options available for vaccines. A simple thing, if you give all government vaccines, then pneumococcus is missed out. In certain states, pneumococcal may be free. I hope it becomes free once India makes pneumococcal vaccines. But I find people who opt to take government vaccines free of charge, then don't end up not getting pneumococcal. So we have to explain to them, come back, go to somebody for pneumococcal. If they come to us or to a paying hospital, then we do have the government vaccine. But we do not have injectable polio vaccine, which is intradermal. Then the government facility says, you went there, so now we are not giving you the intradermal. If I am wrong, please correct me. But this is our experience. So parents are very confused. We take hours counseling parents. It's this or that. If you come here, it's like this. And but one thing we insist upon, that somewhere or the other, the child must take pneumococcal vaccine. And then we, of course, tell them about breastfeeding and danger signs. Now, the family members must be involved, the grandmother, the husband, sister, because unless the family supports the mother, she will not be able to take a decision on any of these, which I have talked about before. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. I end here. One more thing, just before I finish. Sorry, last slide. I want to talk about this term called therapeutic orphan. What is a therapeutic orphan? A child is born, delivered. If it's a very nice husband-wife maternity home, then the husband is, or wife is a pediatrician, there is no therapeutic orphan. But in large hospitals, the child is delivered, sent home, appro rendu vaaram kalichuvaanga, patthu naal kalichuvaanga, child is in problem. He doesn't know where to go. So we must give a phone number or must attach a pediatrician to this child, saying, okay, you visit this person or visit this department on a Monday or a Tuesday, and give room for the parents to be in contact with the pediatrician after discharge. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam, for your excellent presentation. You have made a simple topic very sweet also by your presentation, especially by a tablet column. Day, you have made it very attractive. What are the things to be done on the day one? What investigation, what to look for, everything you have covered. So really enjoyed it. A few questions, madam. Can I? Okay, madam. That is regarding the jaundice.
Yeah.
Now people are exposing the baby to the sunlight. What is your opinion on that?
See, sunlight cannot replace assessing the risk, assessing the risk factors, all those things. Now, if a baby has to benefit from sunlight, he has to be completely naked. Okay, having said that, it is not a treatment for jaundice. So I would personally not substitute sunlight as a treatment for any kind of jaundice. You want to keep your baby in the sun, well and good, it will get some vitamin D. But I would not recommend sunlight as a mode of treatment, especially if you have not assessed risk factors. Because what I find is, if you don't assess risk, the baby is yellow, he's sitting in the sun, for 2-3 days. And sometimes with, so, you know, that will not help. It can be dangerous. So unless, suppose it's a low risk baby, it's day 4. Parents want to keep the baby in the sun, but they have to understand the baby has to be kept naked, and that too not as a treatment for jaundice. So I would personally not recommend sunlight for jaundice at all. I think it's a waste of time.
Thank you, madam. One more question that is about your book on neonatology. Is there any new edition has been come? Book on neonatology.
Book on neonatology. You want one more book? There are already so many in the market.
No. Any new edition? New edition that was asked.
You mean my book, whether there is a new edition? So far, no.
Yours.
So far, no new edition.
Okay, madam. Thank you, madam. Very nice.
Thank you.
Thank the organizers for the IAP TNSC for giving this wonderful opportunity to moderate a lovely session. Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, madam. Please, can you please stop sharing, madam?
Okay.
It was a wonderful session. It was a very practically useful and updating session. Put in a nutshell, excellent presentation, madam. Thank you so much.
Madam, in fact, I want to ask that every slide will be asked as a question to the UG and PG, so that your message will be percolated to the youngsters. Every slide can be asked as a question in the oral, or it can be answered in short form. So every slide is an important part.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.